Like niko na mrathi mwingine anagombana na mzee. I was like, that's disrespectful. But kuangalia tena, I was like, wait.
So what are you doing here, you young lady? That hotel, is it mine or is it for the mama here?
Not my business.
And you're laughing with me. You're laughing with me. You think it's funny. You think it's funny.
Wait.
Rais Uhuru Kenyatta amekuwa katika mstari wa mbele kutekeleza mabadiliko kwenye sekta ya elimu nchini Kenya ili kuwapa watoto wote wa taifa hili nafasi ya kuboresha maisha yao. Wiki hii kwenye Project 254,
quality education systems cannot be realized without enhanced domestic finance, and the focus therefore is on governments to deliver unequivocally on this mandate.
We have all the textbooks that are required, textbooks available, and the textbook is one textbook for one student.
Had it not been for free secondary education, majority of students would not have an opportunity to go through the secondary level.
Do you tell your friends, oh, I've met someone, I think there's something going on here?
Not the first day.
Yeah.
I think after the second or third time, that's when I said, you know, I told my BFF, I'm like, you know, I met this guy, he's cool. I'm like, okay, how old is he? He's 52 years old. She was like, you know, of course it's a shock, you know? And I never thought I would ever be interested in someone who's much older than me. Like, you know, there's no way I thought, So the doctor is like, you know what, you have another baby in your belly, so let's cut
this. That's when you found out?
That's when I found out. I was just like, what? Can you bring in something fresh?
Yeah.
At least make it more entertaining. You know, just don't say the boring usual thing. At huyo ni gukanga, septic tank. Just say something new, you know?
We take it on at the right time.
Honorable Musalia Mudavadi.
The Honorable Mutahi Kagwe.
Chief Justice Martha Karambu Koome.
This is KMBC, the voice of Kenya.
Asking the right questions.
I don't know how it made you feel as speaker who is presiding over a house where members can be compromised with 10,000 shillings.
We keep our guests comfortable, a mission to ensure our audience gets a complete story.
For a few hours or so, I thought this is it. My end has come.
If really we want an end of this pandemic, we must fight.
Our goal, to tell it as it is for the benefit of our viewer.
And I'm sure we will have good discussions.
All right.
That will make probably your viewers understand KDF better.
Okay. With 21 radio outlets.
During a live interview on KBC TV, Chief of Defense Forces, General Robert Kiboshi.
Jaji mkuu kwa mara ya kwanza katika mahojiano yake ya kipekee na runinga ya KBC Channel 1.
And two TV stations covering over 90% of the entire country. The message always gets home. KBC, the home of on-air TV interviews.
A very good afternoon to you. You are in time for the lunchtime news here on KBC Channel 1. My name is Betty Kiptum. My colleague on the sign language interpretation is Lucy Moura. We start off with matters politics, where the Party of National Unity has ratified a memorandum of understanding with the Orange Democratic Party ahead of the 2022 general elections. PNU patron Peter Munya says the party will not field a presidential candidate, but will instead support ODM's candidate, sentiments echoed by Laikipia Governor Nderitu Muridhi.
Just days after announcing the party's National Executive Council had endorsed a decision to work with ODM in readiness for 2022, PNU will now not front a presidential candidate in 2022 and will instead rally behind ODM's candidate.
I've known him in fighting for the governance of this country, ensuring that everything, including what we have said a while ago, happens. Equity, gender mainstreaming, good governance, inclusivity, everything, he has fought for it. If you believe in it, and he is the only one who has been fighting for it, who is available at the table, then the decision to make, the direction, he.
The politics of fear and hatred and suspicion, they are no longer in vogue. And we cannot continue where one community may dislike another on the basis of perhaps cultural practice.
Speaking during a PNU fundraising dinner, party patron Peter Munya said PNU has worked with ODM before and the newly found union is informed by the need to maintain peace in the country.
To have a new government, and we want to be part of that change that is coming. Our NEC passed that resolution that we are now empowered by that organ of the party to start talking to other like-minded parties.
ODM Secretary General Edwin Sifuna lauded the move, saying the two parties have a long history and are best suited to continue with the legacy of President Uhuru Kenyatta.
Mimi nataka kuhakikishia kama chama cha ODM, ule uhusiano ambao tumeanzisha governor, hakuna mtu ataingilia katikati. Hakuna mtu ataingilia kati. Sisi tunaheshimu vyama vyote, haswa vile vilivyoko katika sendo. Nyinyi mmetushika mkono, tunaweza kukwea mlima kwa sababu mnatuonyesha.
We would like to thank very much the PNU Brigade for the partnership and the hard partnership that you've offered us in ODM and our party leader, and the way mmetushikilia. Unajua kupanda mlima si rahisi.
The PNU party leadership says they will field candidates in other elective positions, urging Kenyans to register as voters ahead of the elections.
And now we want to take you to Eldoret, where ODM party leader is on his campaign trail. And Simon Achola is following up on that story. Achola, what is the latest from Eldoret?
Well, thank you very much, Betty. We are indeed in Uasin Gishu County, specifically at a place called Kenmosa, which is on the outskirts of Eldoret town, where the former Prime Minister Raila Amolo Odinga is actually holding his Azimio la Umoja campaign. Of course, as he has repeatedly explained, that this is a rallying call to all leaders and Kenyans at large to actually join forces so then we can actually realize a peaceful and united country. So today he is actually here in Uasin Gishu County, and he's continuing with his campaign just to rally Kenyans to actually support this campaign, but more importantly call on all leaders to ensure that indeed they are they preach peace as we head into the next poll and beyond. Betty, now it is well known that Uasin Gishu County is one of the bread baskets of this country, and when Raila comes to this region, that is one of the reasons why he'll actually be discussing. And indeed today the leaders who have actually spoke in this forum have actually insisted on the need for the government to actually allocate more resources and ensure that indeed the agriculture sector in the country is revived. Taking the cue, former Prime Minister Raila Odinga actually said that they will do everything within their means, especially if he assumes the reins of power, to ensure that indeed the agriculture sector is allocated enough resources, and more importantly in line line with the Maputo declaration that says that close to 10% of the national budget should be allocated to the agricultural sector so that then they can actually create enough resources for the government. The Prime Minister saying that the reason why we still, this country cannot effectively compete with other nations or imports from other nations is that the cartels and corrupt officials have actually joined forces to ensure that farm inputs are extremely expensive for ordinary mwananchi, and that is why production of food crops actually in this country is very expensive. But he says unless resources are actually put into the agriculture sector to ensure that the prices actually come down, production prices actually come down, then it's going to be extremely difficult for this country to compete against other nations. What else? Well, the other thing he's actually saying is that he wants to ensure that there are enough resources to make agricultural sector more attractive to the youth so that then we can actually continue to have more people and specifically the youth joining into the sector and ensure that the prices go down, and more importantly also so that then the local companies can continue to manufacture goods that can actually be consumed here in the country. And he goes on to say that it is time to actually start utilizing what is made in Kenya. More importantly also, Betty, just in conclusion, he actually talked about corruption as he has always done in his campaigns, and he says that one of the reasons as to why this country cannot move forward is the issue of corruption. And he says that the reason why we are seeing some of the leaders actually doing trips in and out of the country in neighboring countries and of course holding fund drives in different sessions in different places is actually money that has actually been stolen in the country, stored in the offshore accounts, but they are trying as much as they can to ensure that the money comes back into the country so that then they can actually use it in campaigns. More importantly, on the issue of corruption, the former Prime Minister says that this country is actually losing quite a lot in terms of resources, and he says both at the national level and at the county level, much is actually going to the drain, and it is important that actually this money is ring-fenced to ensure that his pet project that he's actually just started talking about the other day, the social welfare fund, is actually utilized. And he says that this country has enough resources, not just to give the 6,000 shillings that he's actually promising to vulnerable and poor families across the country, but he says he can actually go up to 10,000 Kenya shillings. Of course, Betty, that is something that we will be closely following to see indeed how he's actually going to ensure that he actually implements what he's saying, if indeed he assumes the reins of powers. But more importantly, to break it down further so that then we can get to understand exactly when he says that he'll be giving out resources to the vulnerable and poor families, how exactly he's actually going to do so. We will keep following his trails from here. We are told that he's going to Huruma Estate, which is along Bungoma Eldoret, Ubuye Eldoret route, and of course he's expected to actually address and his supporters along the way to Huruma, and of course from there he's expected in Kakamega, and of course also in Kisumu County, where he is expected to attend to a funeral to the daughter of the former governor of Kisumu County, Jaka Ranguma. Back to you, Betty.
Thank you very much, Simon Achola, there in Eldoret, just bringing us the latest on Raila Odinga's campaign trail. He is in Eldoret and he will be going to a number of locations thereafter. He says that corruption as well as social welfare are top of his agenda, including agriculture, to ensure that the backbone of the nation is prospering. Well, it looks like agriculture is quite a topic in the campaign trails, because Wiper Party leader Kalonzo Musyoka is promising a green gold revolution when he becomes the president, and agriculture will be the center of driving the economy. Kalonzo made the remarks after meeting the Senate Committee on Agriculture that was visiting at Wikithuki Irrigation Scheme in Seikuru, Kitui County, that has been taken over by the national government through the National Irrigation Authority.
Noting the milestones which have so far been achieved at Wikithuki, Kalonzo said that actualization of the Vision 2030 Grand Falls Dam was the only solution to food insecurity in the country, as it would ensure that maximum land is put under irrigation at Wikithuki. The scheme was started by the Grand Coalition government under President Mwai Kibaki when he was the vice president.
That project, the High Grand Falls, has capacity to irrigate all this land up to Tana River. And you imagine what that will mean to all of us in this country. So, Mheshimiwa Ntwiga, and senators to the country that this is where the future lies.
The Wiper Party leader called on other contenders in the 2022 race to come up with life-changing ideas and desist from politics of deception. Kitui Senator Enoch Wambua, who is the vice chair of the committee, said that the committee was guided by the recent declaration of drought as a national disaster and would push the government to allocate some funds which were set aside for drought mitigation to expand and power the project using solar.
We are guided by the recent declaration by His Excellency the President of drought as a national disaster and the setting up of a drought mitigation fund. And so our thinking is that part of that fund and another fund that could be available could be channeled to this project.
The area MP, Engineer Paul Nzegu, said that leaders from Kitui were in full support of the project.
That we are behind this project, whichever way we can contribute, so that his vision that he had those years when he was the Vice President of the Republic of Kenya, that we can support his vision and ensure that our community really gains from that idea.
And majority of leaders from Olmoran and Ngarua division in Laikipia County are yet to resume school. This is as a result of escalating cases of insecurity occasioned by banditry attacks which have left the residents scared.
Whatever it is that you're targeting, right? Yes. I think those...
Primary school in Olmoran. No pupil has reported by midday Wednesday, while at Tumaini Academy, which is run by the Catholic Church, at least 75% of learners had resumed learning, according to the school manager. Majority of those yet to report to school are pupils who come from the pastoral communities who had fled as a result of rising cases of banditry attacks.
Kama one or two about how bado hawajarudi. Na ninafikiria ni kwa sababu wengi wanaangalia kama watu wamerudi, wanaangalia situation iko aje katika kijiji cha Galinarok.
Parents have expressed fear of more attacks, claiming criminals who have been terrorizing them are still walking around scot-free.
Tuko na ushungu juu ya hawa wakora wanakuja kuua watoto wetu. Kwa hivyo tunasikia ushungu kwa sababu hata watoto hawasomi. Tutafanya nini? Na maendeleo ni masomo ya watoto hawaendi shule.
Olmoran Division Education Officer Patrick Kimani says the government has put enough measures to ensure the safety of the local communities, adding that security has also been provided within the schools to guarantee the safety of learners.
But there is much more that needs to be done. And we request that they try as much as possible to see that the security is restored.
Now, the inaugural Commonwealth Parliamentarians with Disabilities African Region Conference is ongoing in Nairobi, and it has representation of five countries in Africa, that is Kenya, Uganda, Tanzania, Sierra Leone, as well as South Africa. Now, our reporter Kamche Menza is on standby with the report on that particular conference. Kamche, what is the latest?
Well, Kiptum, good afternoon. Back in studio, we are coming to you live from Serena Hotel, where the Commonwealth Parliamentarians Association is actually holding an inaugural conference to discuss on matters. This is the Commonwealth Parliamentarians Association on parliamentarians with disabilities. This is the first or the foremost meeting that they have convened here in Nairobi. But it's a meeting that has brought on board parliamentarians, like you said, from five countries, that is South Africa, Sierra Leone, Kenya, Tanzania, and Uganda. The main agenda of the day is about mainstreaming disability considerations in legislative agenda in the 21st century. I'm joined by the chair of the Commonwealth Parliamentarians with Disability, that is Honorable Danita Gati, to actually tell us what has informed this particular meeting and actually the rationale behind this meeting. Karibu sana Mhesh. Maybe to start us off, off, like I said, your first question will be, what is the rationale of this particular meeting?
The rationale for this particular meeting is basically the fact that within our parliaments, in the Africa region and even globally, you realize that not many members of parliament are parliamentarians with disabilities. You know, that tells you something, that persons with disabilities hardly make it to parliament. You know, they're hardly elected, they're hardly, you know, they're just voters. And therefore, in line again with Article 29 of the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, which of course Kenya is a signatory to, Kenya has ratified the convention, it is basically a convention that actually obligates state parties to actually make sure that persons with disabilities have rights in the political process. So Kenya has actually provided all these rights through the constitution, you know, through the Persons with Disabilities Act, you know, through so many other, you know, policies. And that's why we are in parliament, as members of parliament with disabilities. And as the chair of the Commonwealth Parliamentarians with Disabilities Network, I felt through the CPA Africa region that we need to actually advance this discussion in Africa region. As you can see, we have delegates from 5 countries of Africa to come and help us chart a way forward. We want to map a way forward as Africans, because Africa is our business and disability is our business. And therefore, we want to basically discuss how do we increase the representation of persons with disabilities in parliament, you know, both as voters and both as candidates and both as members of parliament. So we want to basically converge in Nairobi. And I'm happy this is the first meeting in Africa region to be supported by the CPA. To discuss the way forward for persons with disability to get into parliament first, and then once we're also in parliament, how do we make it conducive for members of parliament to operate, to work with ease like any other member of parliament without a disability. So this meeting basically is to help us chart a way forward as MPs with disability in the Africa region of the Commonwealth. Okay. You know, so because I'm in charge of the entire world, I'm in charge of 9 regions of the world. We have started in Africa, and Kenya has been chosen as the best country because of obviously over how fair we are as a country to persons with disabilities. We are here for 3 days, basically, you know, looking at our strategic plan that we have developed, looking at you know, so many other challenges, looking at what we can do as a community of Africa to make sure that persons with disabilities are represented not only socially but even politically.
All right.
Yeah,
there is one thing that you've mentioned about countries having ratified in the UN Convention. There are about 18 countries, and we understand there are few countries that do not have representation in the parliament, in their parliament. For example, Mauritius, Eswatini. How do you, as an association, plan to go about this in your fight for representation in all the other parliaments?
Correct. We take note that out of even the members, member countries who are members of the Commonwealth, we have countries like Eswatini, as you say, that have no representation of members of parliament with disabilities, even in CPA. What we want to achieve as a Commonwealth clarion call is to ensure that persons with disabilities, I mean countries actually, ensure, you know, that persons with disabilities make it to parliament. I mean, we want to lobby parliaments, or we want to lobby countries to look at their constitution, because all these issues are issues within the constitution. The countries must relook at their constitutions to ensure provisions for persons with disabilities to be elected or nominated. You know, affirmative action must actually be there in countries to ensure that persons with disabilities get themselves into parliament. And once they get into parliament, they also get into representation of the CPA. So once we are there, that's then we have a voice as members of parliament with disabilities to be able. So the policies that we're seeking to develop are policies that are going to enable us to push countries of the Commonwealth to ensure that, you know, they are fair to persons with disabilities getting themselves into parliament.
After having ratified the UN Convention.
Especially after having ratified the UN Convention, because most of our countries in the Commonwealth are countries that have ratified the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. We want to see now these countries domesticate this UN Convention into their policies and laws. So this conference is basically, you know, coming up with policies that we are going to actually not really push, but we are going to lobby. We are going to lobby. We know we cannot change constitutions of countries, but we can use CPA to lobby and basically, you know, push our own agenda as members of parliament with disabilities, to also see other countries having representation as members of parliament with disabilities in Eswatini, for example, in Lesotho, for example, and many other countries. Yes.
And we understand that South Africa and Tanzania are leading actually in representation. South Africa has 8. Also, Tanzania has 8. Kenya, we have seen, have 7. So we are not doing badly so far.
We are not doing badly, and Uganda has 5. Okay. I mean, and our constitutions are the sure ways and tools to ensure that representation of persons with disabilities is there. And you can see again, Kenya, in our county assemblies. I mean, so many of our county assemblies have county assembly members who have disability. The 2-2 that are required by law. Every county in this country must have 2 members of county assembly with disability, a man and a woman. So we want to close the loopholes and ensure that those counties that do not have representation of persons with disabilities must have representation in the next election and beyond.
Well said, Mheshimiwa Danita Gati. Thank you. Brief but straight to the point. The message has been passed. Thank you so much, Betty Kiptum. Back to you in studio.
Thank you very much, Kamche Menza, there, just coming to us with that interview with the chair of the persons with disability, the parliamentarians with disability all over the world, just seeking to ensure that representation of persons with disability in the lawmaking process through parliament is enhanced. We move on to other news. Ibrahim Kipkemboi Rotich. We take a quick break now. When we come back, we'll be giving you that story. Do stay with us.
This week, the spotlight is on Ben Soul, the face of Soul Generation. Lucy, I love you. The artist is a multi-instrumentalist, talented songwriter, and soulful singer. Lucy. The versatile musician has hit singles like Lucy, Forget You, favorite song under his belt.
I love you like the sunshine in the morning. When I'm yawning, like the scent of love.
Catch Ben Soul on Easy Friday at 9:45 p.m. with Shiksha Arora, only on KBC Channel 1.
Okay.
Jana na Jane.
You proposed to me. Iyo mali itukutange tuko mbele when you're ready an item. Christine, I thought you guys said you're broke.
Jen, don't let this house fool you. We are broke.
Tumangushe.
What?
Ama ofe mexpire sasa.
Ofa ya nini?
Pete is at your place. Bacha ni chukwe bag tuende.
Why are you not having these same clothes yesterday? So? Get rid of Lawrence.
Mark?
Christine.
Speaking fluently comes easily for most of us. However, it can be a challenge to some.
Stammering is a speech disorder. It means the speech is not in order.
When did you discover you had a problem with your speech?
At the age of 4, because my fellow kids were speaking so. So. Fluent.
What needs to be addressed, like he's talking about?
Giving information to the teachers. Most teachers have no idea that this is a case of stammering. So if they are made aware, they will be handled differently.
Thank you for staying with the Channel One Lunchtime News. Now, Ibrahim Kipkemboi Rotich, the key suspect in the murder of former world cross-country champion Agnes Debet Tirop, is being held at an unidentified location in Mombasa County as detectives continue with investigations. Rotich was arrested on Thursday night in Changamwe constituency, and according to the Directorate of Criminal Investigations, he will be arraigned in court to answer to murder charges.
Ngoma Police Commander David Mathias said Ibrahim Kipkemboi Rotich was arrested in the company of a male friend at 8:45 p.m. Thursday around Chaani area, Changamwe constituency.
Mshukiwa huyu ambaye ni mhusika mkuu katika mauaji haya ya Agnes Jebet Tirop aliweza kushikwa katika eneo la Chaani hapa Changamwe na maafisa wetu wa polisi. Alikuwa na mwenzake ambaye pia tunaendelea na uchunguzi kujua walikuwa wanashughuligani na yeye.
Police recovered two phones from Rotich, one of which is suspected to belong to slain athlete Agnes Jebet Tirop.
Among the items that were recovered from the suspect are two mobile phones, of which one is highly suspected to have been owned by the late Agnes Jebet. And the other one, maybe after the investigations are completed, we'll be able to know who is the owner of the other mobile phone.
It is still unclear where the 41-year-old is being held, with unconfirmed reports indicating he is at the Port Police Station. The vehicle he was driving is parked at the Chaani Police Station. According to the Directorate of Criminal Investigations, Rotich had rammed his getaway vehicle into a lorry at Athi River along Mombasa Road as he tried to escape a police dragnet. The late Tirop, a rising long-distance runner, was found dead on Wednesday at her home in Iten Elgeyo Marakwet County with stab wounds on her body. For Lunchtime News from Mombasa County, I am Ann Mburu.
Uhuru Kenyatta on Thursday made history by becoming the first African head of state to be hosted by President Joe Biden at the White House since taking office in January this year. Trade, COVID-19 and climate change were top agenda during the meeting between the two heads of state.
At the historic meeting between President Uhuru Kenyatta and the U.S. President Joe Biden on Thursday, the U.S. government announced a donation of 17 million more COVID-19 vaccines to the African Union, a move that was welcomed by President Kenyatta.
Well behind the rest of the world in terms of being able to vaccinate our people. So any additional support, like the President has mentioned, is greatly welcome, and we look forward to that continued partnership.
On the war against terrorism, President Kenyatta applauded the U.S. for being a strong partner for Kenya.
The Kenya where we had an opportunity to meet with the Vice President, when we come over again on issues related to strengthening the partnership and the relationship between our two countries, and it's really a great pleasure and honor to see you again.
President Kenyatta said Kenya was keen on deepening its trade and investment relations with the U.S. by investing in partnerships that promote American business interests while advancing the country's socio-economic transformation agenda. The Kenyan leader said his country had made tremendous progress in climate change adaptation and mitigation and welcomed the U.S. back to the Paris Agreement.
This is an area where Kenya has made tremendous progress in her own right, and where we are firmly committed to the Paris Agreement, and we're glad to see the United States now joined. And we look forward to working very closely together on my particular agenda.
The White House meeting was a culmination of President Kenyatta's successful official visit of the U.S., during which he chaired his first United Nations Security Council meeting at the UN headquarters in New York. Purity Museo, Lunchtime News.
The leadership of Lake Victoria South Water Works Development Agency is calling for calm among residents of Korando in Kisumu County over an ongoing water and sanitation project in the area. The agency's chairperson, Dan Omino, noted that the opposition to the project is as a result of misinformation peddled by individuals with selfish interests. The project is jointly funded by the national government and development partners. Weekly for Catch with the details.
According to Dan Omino, the board chairperson of Lake Victoria South Water Works Development Agency, the sanitation project is behind schedule. Omino says opposition of the project by locals is an obstacle to its progress. On Wednesday this week, a section of locals took to the street to protest the proposed establishment of a water treatment plant in the area, claiming lack of public participation.
We have actually tried through the chairman of the landowners to reach them out and ask them about the documents which I mentioned, the environmental impact assessment, the feasibility study and the mapping. What acreage or the entire size of the project? They have refused to unveil all these documents. So we cannot discuss a project that we don't know how large it's going to be. For those who are taking part in other meetings, there's another group which claim that they own land here. They don't have any piece of land here. Yes, yes. And we want to tell Dan Omino, the chairman of Lake Victoria Water Works, that those people who engages him, they are not bona fide members of this area. Yeah. They don't have any piece of land in this area. Yeah. If at all they are engaged in any way, they are going to lose the battle. Yeah.
However, Omino dismissed the claims, terming them a product of misinformation.
We want to express our concerns about a lot of misinformation which has emerged. And in some cases, we want to encourage members of the public that Lake Victoria South Water Works Development Agency is a public institution. Every member of society who is a taxpayer has a right to approach us to receive the appropriate information so that they can get informed decisions.
According to the agency, the two-fold project of a clean water supply and a water treatment plant will cost about 8 billion shillings and funded by the national government alongside a consortium of international partners.
When the president signed this very financial arrangement, the tune was about 8 billion. That includes the clean water supply, and out of that just 800 million would go to the water treatment plant.
Omino urging for calm among the locals, saying the project, which is currently in preliminary stages, will benefit the more than 350,000 residents of Kisumu and help in preventing further pollution of Lake Victoria.
It is acknowledged globally that clean water is a right to every individual existing in this world. And equally, improved water is a right, improved sanitation is a right to the same individuals. So as a public entity, we are pursuing realization of the right to clean water and the right to improved sanitation.
Reporting for Lunchtime News, I'm Wycliffe Okech.
Nakuru Member of County Assembly Wilson Mwangi is leading a team of well-wishers to help street families in Nakuru Town to get food. The MCA is in the meantime challenging the government to hasten the establishment of a national policy aimed at providing a systematic and sustainable framework for the rehabilitation of street families in Kenya.
Over 80 street families in Nakuru County have received relief of foodstuff and clothing from local leaders and well-wishers in the region. Speaking in Nakuru during the donation exercise, Menengai East MCA Wilson Mwangi said there was need to control the rising numbers of street families in the county that has brought about insecurity in the town's CBD. With mainly women falling victim to some rogue urchins.
Lazima tuone ni jambo gani ambalo tutalifanya ili kuhakikisha ya kwamba hawa watoto tumewaondoa katika mitaani mwetu na waende wajengewe pahali wanaweza enda wakae na wapate mafunzo.
Joseph Karanja from Agape Givers also said they are willing to facilitate those street families who want to acquire skills by enrolling them in vocational trainings to acquire technical skills.
Tunatoa nafasi kwa wale ambao wangeapenda sana kujiunga na vyuo, kujiunga na shule ya tuseme kama ni kutengeneza nywele, tuseme kama ni shule ya electronic ama mambo ya stima. Hiyo yote ndio tuna facilitate.
Sentiments echoed by Sally Wambui from the English Club Movement that has partnered with Sulwe and the American Embassy in a program that has seen many benefit from education, shelter and life skill experiences.
Tumekuwa tukiwapatia chakula, tunawapatia nguo, mavazi.
Vile vile tuta make sure wametengenezwa nywele. Both men and women, wote watatengenezwa nywele, watashukwa.
Street Family Group Chairman Charles Opio said the move to assist them was much welcome as the numbers have gone higher now compared to other years.
Kwa hivyo sisi tunaomba kama Street Family, pia sisi ni wa Kenya na tumezaliwa na wazazi kama vile wengine wamezaliwa. Na tunaomba sana tukae na maisha mzuri kulingana na vile county itatuchukulia na serikali kuu.
For Lunchtime News, I'm Nisi Imano Okoth.
Of locals have flocked Medanta Africa Hospital for free cancer screening. The hospital's chief executive officer, Vikas Gelot, says the three-day exercise is meant to give back to the society as a corporate responsibility and help Kenyans understand their health.
Africa Care Hospital is undertaking a 3 days free cancer screening as part of celebrating the Cancer Awareness Month.
Mimi nimefanywa screening hapa Medanta, ni free cancer screening. So naambia wale watu wako nyumbani mkuje mfanywe screening. Ni vizuri kujijulia hali. Mimi nisha screeniwa na nimejijulia hali yangu.
Na inaweza zuiwa isikuwe na gharamia kwa sababu kwa gharama ni very much expensive na inafanya hata matajiri wanakuwa maskini kwa sababu inafika kiwango ambayo matibabu yake na hata madawa zake ni too much expensive.
While officially launching the exercise, the hospital CEO Vikas Gelot says the move is meant to give back to the society that has supported the institution in its growth.
Of course, I think people should be given the option. It is always to open the door so that people can have that initial screening because they deserve it. Sometimes cost is something that is an impediment, so people don't feel that they should do it. But if we can give this as a helping hand to alert people to some red flags that are being raised within their system, then of course it's something that we want to offer the community and the people.
Being a cancer month, this will be a good opportunity for us to do your screening. Those who have been diagnosed with COVID, for instance, when you have COVID pneumonia, among the things that your doctor requests you to do is a CT scan of your chest. So if you're able to, this is something that you could take advantage of.
Gelot challenged other medical facilities to come out and offer free screening to members of the public as part of preventive measures.
Because cancer is a big growing issue, and the earlier you can pick it up, of course you have a better chance of fighting it. It's an issue which is growing in the country, and preventative care is always the best approach.
He is appealing to members of the public to take advantage of the event and get checked.
Residents of Ganze in Kilifi County have now resorted to slaughtering their livestock as drought continues to bite. The locals say they are losing their animals in big numbers and have no option left but to slaughter them. They want the government to intervene and save them from further misery.
Drought is worsening in Ganze, Kilifi County, with hundreds of residents already affected. For pastoralists, pasture is hard to come by and their animals are dying in their thousands with fears of a catastrophe.
Hakuna manyasi, hakuna maji, nikukaa tu nazo tu hivi tayari hivi, lakini hakuna maji, hakuna kila kitu.
Tuwaleta ng'ombe kunywa maji na ng'ombe zetu zina mali zikakufa kwa sababu ya njaa. Hata hapa mahali ambapo kwamba niko na hizi nyama Ng'ombe nkufa jana usiku, nshindwa kunywa maji ikashindwa.
Going round this region, one is met by carcasses of cattle, a smell of rotten meat everywhere. One of the residents, Karisa Muhambi, says the drought had really affected them as their livestock is being wiped out.
Kuna ng'ombe saba ambao wamekufa kufikia sasa. Ni asubuhi tumeamka na hii moja imekufa. Na tumechinja. Sasa tuananza kuanika-anika.
At the Thema village in Mriachakwe area, we come across a family that had slaughtered a cow that was in the verge of dying.
Itwa mimi wana chukua tu ngozi nipatie umbwa, lakini itwa tunje sedie kuchinja. Sahi wajua shida kwa sababu ukame ni mwingi. Ngombe ikifa hivyo, kama ngombe ya 15,000, 20,000 ukiuza ukipata 1,000 huwa amepata. Afuaya maji hapa sasa yanatumika na kila
Kenya Red Cross Society Coast Regional Manager Hassan Musa says out of the 6 coastal counties, Kilifi, Kwale and Lamu are most affected.
Not only are human beings who are being affected by drought, but even animals. We've lost so far over 6,500 livestock in Kilifi County, and we've also lost over 4,000, and this figure might also go up in Tana River. And we're also experiencing a huge number of deaths of livestock in Lamu County.
Locals are now calling for government's intervention.
Tunaomba serikali ingilie kati iweze kutusaidia. Itupe chakula, mfugo wetu pia upate njia ya kupona.
Purity Museo, Lunchtime News.
Timothy Maneno has been elected as the Makueni County Assembly, to represent the Nguma Sumba ward. Maneno, an independent candidate, emerged victorious in Thursday's by-election with 2902 votes, beating United Democratic Alliance Party candidate Daniel Kivuva, who garnered 2219 votes. Eshio Maiwa of Wiper Democratic Movement came in third with 1614 votes. The Nguma Sumba ward seat fell vacant in June this year following the death of Harrison Ngui.
Uru wapigaji kura na wakaaji wa Nguma Sumba kwa sababu wamefanya kama wao, na hata kukiwa kulikuwa na ushauri wa namna gani wa vyama, wamesema kwamba wao watachagua mtu anajisimamisha, Timothy Maneno.
Within this short time tutahakikisha tumewafanyia kazi mzuri, and I think out of this one, let me take also this opportunity to say to my competitors, let us join hands, see whether we can also deliver for Masumba Ngu residents.
Do the business news. The cost of milk is expected to remain stable this year despite the current drought and increased demand. Dairy Board Managing Director Margaret Kibogi says the country has enough milk powder in the strategic food reserve to last the country up to the next long rains.
Milk prices have increased marginally recently, with half a litre of milk retailing at an average of 53 shillings. However, the dairy board says the increase in milk consumer prices is as a result of high fuel costs that has heightened operation costs and disrupted the value chain.
When you look at the challenges, of course, you could see the cost of electricity could have gone up. Yeah, yeah, the fuel could have gone up. And of course, you know, we transport milk from all over to go to the processing plant.
This, as the government says, it will not allow importation of milk, as the current milk stock in the country is sufficient to last the country for 4 months till the next long rains.
We have surplus. We convert milk into powder. And this is given through the new KCC. So we will be able to remove the same to the industry to be able to supplement if there is any deficit. We will be looking at the existing stock through the SFR, because when we have the surplus, as usual, we always convert milk into powder.
The production of milk increased by 20% between July and September this year to 76 million liters as milk producing counties received adequate short rains. Milk processors want the government to allow importation of animal feeds to subsidize the fodder in the country and reduce the overall cost of production.
Cost of feeds is high in the country, but again, remember, like somebody said, those costs have come down a little, but not enough.
Last month, the government said it was assessing the current fodder stock in the country due to the drought experienced in different parts of the country before making a decision on feeds importation. Benson Ryoba reporting for Lunchtime News.
The agriculture sector will take a few years to fully recover from the effects of the COVID-19 pandemic, which saw borders closed and a ban on some imports imposed. The Eastern Africa Farmers Federation says the situation has been worsened by a rise in post-harvest losses and climate change, which has led to unpredictable weather patterns.
This emerged during the 5th East African Farmers Federation annual conference in Naivasha, where lack of support by government towards the agriculture sector emerged as the main challenge. According to EAFF President Elizabeth Nsimadala, exports were the most affected at the height of the pandemic, which left farmers counting losses running into millions of shillings.
Political uncertainties, they usually, of course, at the end affect the farmers. Because, of course, you know, even with the post-harvest losses that we are experiencing currently without even the COVID, they are as high as 40%. So if you get the losses by post-harvest handling, then plus the losses that were caused by COVID, then you can see that the figure ranges, you know, over above 70%.
It was estimated that the agriculture sector lost 70% of its revenue to the pandemic, with 40% related to post-harvest losses. Nsimadala identified coffee, milk, flowers, fisheries, fruits, and beef as the most affected after countries closed down their borders as part of mitigation measures to stop the spread of the virus. EAFF CEO Stephen Mushiri said that the pandemic had seen total losses of farm produce and pointed to horticulture as the most affected. He emphasized that the full effect of the pandemic were yet to be fully felt as he challenged the government to support farmers through subsidies.
Like the reports are showing in terms of climate change, like this year, you can see it was supposed to be in short rains. More than half of the country, there's no rains. There's drought, okay? These events are happening every 2 or 3 years now. If you're not investing in managing and mitigating drought effects, you're not investing in terms of storage, you're not investing in terms of value addition, yeah? Then where are we actually going to be in the next 10 years?
Reporting for Lunchtime News, my name is Hibak Said.
Now, attaining food sufficiency has for generations been a primary objective worldwide, with thousands currently staring at starvation owing to drought in 10 counties. Where is Kenya failing? Our reporter Regina Manyara highlights reflections of Agra Country Manager John Masharia ahead of the World Food Day set for 16th October.
Auctions are our future. What needs to be done to increase the resilience of our farmers? Taking us through that conversation is none other than the country manager, Agra, John Masharia. Thank you, sir, for your time.
I think the first thing is to make available yield-enhancing technologies, seeds, fertilizers, and efficacious pesticides that can first of all help them increase their yields. But currently we have seeds and other varieties that are disease-resistant, are drought-tolerant, are early maturing, and these are basically technologies that if in the hands of farmers, they would be able to help them, you know, weather the effects of drought. But the second thing to say is that we also have financial technologies such as crop insurance that Agra has helped introduce it to the country, that even in the face of drought you would be able to get some form of rebate that would allow you to afford seeds and fertilizers and provide some form of ease in that regard. But I believe the government is also doing efforts from a support or an easing standpoint, and they're providing some form of food relief together with other donors. They're providing some cash disbursements that are also helping people to be able to survive during these difficult times.
What are the low-hanging fruits in as far as technology and input can we adopt to ensure that we remain food secure?
The first more obvious one, and it's also the difficult one to address, is actually to be able to structure markets in a way that provides incentives for smallholder farmers to grow different varieties or different crops, but also take up newer technologies. Because in any value chain, the market price is really the incentive that drives people to make agribusiness decisions and also drives the decision and choice of what to grow. That's number one. The second thing is to improve the adoption of, you know, climate smart technologies. Right now, I think in our estimation, that is still woefully low. But if you begin to take up things like plant basins that we are seeing in Makueni, if you begin to take up, you know, drought-resistant seeds, if you take early maturing seeds, things would begin to turn.
The time rife for us as Kenyans to change our dietary habits as well as diversify our food basket.
It was time yesterday, not today. For a number of reasons, and I think you know, the president, the minister have been on you know, telling the country to begin to diversify away from maize, because maize has also become a very political crop. But also you have more nutritious crops like millet, you have soybean, you have sorghum that you can actually take that are more not only more nutritious but actually offer smallholder farmers more income. The other important thing as you think about nutrition is the emergence of obesity as also a pandemic that is beginning to build. So if we can get the consumers to take up more healthier vegetables, your brendam, chicha, and things like that, things can actually be able to turn.
What are your reflections ahead of the World Food Day?
The average age of a farmer today is anywhere between 65 and 75 years old. 30 years from now, that's not going to be the person putting your food on the table. So how do we bring the youth to be the farmer and to be the center of an agricultural transformation as we head into 2030, 2050. The second thing is to say that agriculture is the center of development. All the things we need to be doing and investing in, we need to be doing it to ensure that people are having access to food. Food is affordable and food is secure. There's food safety. That is important because, you know, if you have a nutritious population, you reduce on your medical bills, but people who have good nutrients are also good learners. So if you think about your kids, you think about the hospitals, food really is at the center of all this. So how do we bring Ministry of Water, Ministry of Trade, Ministry of Roads, and quite a number of people to coordinate around providing food? The last thing is we need to continue to implore African governments to increase their budgetary allocation towards agriculture and just get rid of this disproportionate allocation of, you know, the funds going into agriculture vis-a-vis the contribution of GDP into agriculture. And the last thing is, how do we take up technology? ICT is out there. We have AI, artificial intelligence technologies that are out there. How do we take them up and make them to come to bear for smallholder farmers? And how do we take them up to ensure that our value chains are more efficient, that they provide more market information, that they're used for better extension, you know, and things like that?
As the world looks on to mark the World Food Day, remember, our actions are our future. I'm Regina Manyara. You're watching KBC Channel 1.
In sports news, former Kenyan Premier League champions Gor Mahia will face Al Ahly SC Merowe of Sudan tonight in the first round match of the CAF Confederations Cup. The team held a training session in Egypt where the match will be played behind closed doors.
Difference in the tempo. You still have to take care. You still have to make sure of your pass. The quality does improve. You should be so confident of being able to move the ball.
Manchester United return to Premier League action after the international break with an away trip to the East Midlands on Saturday to take on Leicester City at the King Power Stadium. For these and more, here is a look at the weekend sports diary.